Hello, Automata 2020. This is Andy Winscher. I'm giving my talk recorded as I missed my slot because my laptop crashed. So I'm going to share my screen now and share. And the topic of my talk is Isotropic Cellular Automata, the DD Lab Isorule Paradigm. Papers in the works, and the preprint will be available shortly. Check on the DD Lab website. Now, I contend that cellular automata would benefit from being isotropic, and an isotropic system can be expressed more efficiently than a full lookup table, although there are also default types of CA rules, which are isotropic anyway, totalistic, reaction, diffusion, survival, birth, and so on. And I'm interested in gathering more examples of glider gun eater dynamics in a search for some underlying principles of self-organization. An isotropic rule will always conserve its symmetry. So here's some examples in 2D, hex or square, and 3D. Now, ISO rules, which is the name I've given to this type of formulation, is we are able to run these rules in discrete dynamics lab for the following neighborhood templates. V is the value range, but it can be multi-value range as well. So, and K is the neighborhood size. So these are the various templates, and various shades of 2D and also in 3D. Looking at full lookup tables, Wolfram's convention, which I follow, will order the neighborhoods according to the decimal values from left to right. And then the lookup table outputs will be strung below. This is rule 60. The same thing would apply to any other rule type, including multi-value. Looking at isotropic subsets of rule types which are by default isotropic, T code is simply the total of values in the neighborhood, and K code looks at the frequency of values in the neighborhood. Now, for binary, they're identical, but K code becomes more interesting to actually search for interesting rules. Reaction diffusion, well-known cycle of excitation and refractory resting within the threshold. Survival birth, can be selected in DD Lab, and this is the game of life. It can be expressed as a full lookup table and then transformed into an ISO rule. There are other notations that look at binary more templates, which I should mention. Hensel notation for Golly, which is which I've made compatible within DD Lab, and Manuel Sapin's notation from his various publications. But I think that my method is more general and simpler. Now, the algorithm takes any full lookup table string and will convert it to isotropic. And once it's done that, it converts the isotropic full lookup table into an ISO rule. And here's some examples. Now, how long is the lookup table for an ISO rule for 2 and 3D. Actually, that's difficult to calculate analytically, but no, I haven't managed to find anyone to help me find an expression for that. But DDLab does it algorithmically. And here's some examples, tables showing the sizes for 2D and 3D. We're interested in these templates at the moment. Now, examples of ISO groups, which will be represented by the left prototype. So a particular pattern on the template can be spun and flipped in all ways to produce the rest of the group. Sometimes there's only one, sometimes there are two, etc. Sometimes there are many. And here's some examples for the three templates we're interested in. If we list all the prototypes of the ISO groups in order from high to low, still following Wolfram's idea. So in a Hensel template binary, we have all the ones and all the zeros and all the prototypes in between, there are 102 of them. The same principle for V3K7 hex, and the same principle for 3D. Now we come to looking at iterating spacetime patterns that simultaneously examining the frequency of lookups of the lookup table, which we can turn into a histogram. And this is the frequency in a moving window of time steps, which could be one, but in this case, it's 100. And this actually is for the Syab rule glider gun, gives this histogram. We take this histogram and we measure its entropy normalized between 0 and 1. And we can plot that as a dynamic graph beside the histogram. However, it's actually more clear to show the histogram bars as a log 2 of the frequency. Otherwise, they're either too big or too small. At the same time, we can use the histogram to filter. And the filtering is done progressively from high to low of the bars, and a black dot is placed under each bar that is filtered, and it can be unfiltered in opposite direction. And here's an example for a V3K7 template with a very interesting rule that leads to spirals by the collision of gliders. Now, the other simultaneous game we can play, as well as mutation, we can, as well as filtering, we can mutate. So this is an example of the spiral rule glider gun. This is its histogram. There are many gaps, so some patterns of the neighborhood are never visited. We can, if we filter all of these active bars, then when we mutate randomly, the algorithms will aim at unfiltered bars. And so we can completely change the rule in many, many respects without affecting the glider gun at all, because these items in the ISO rule lookup table are neutral. However, if we put in another initial state, it'll obviously have great consequences. So that means that there are billions of rules that will include the spiral rule glider gun. So we continue. Input entropy and min-max variability. So we iterate, and this is a game of life from a random initial state for 250 time steps, as we iterate the spacetime patterns, we plot the normalized entropy, and we measure, we seek the biggest upslope within this range of the run. We must ignore the initial, in this case, 22 steps in order to let the system sort of sort itself out, if you like. Now, we've got these entropy measures, and we can do a scatter plot sampling many, many rules from random initial states and see where they fall on this graph, where X is the entropy variability, the min-max, X-axis, and Y is the mean entropy. And Z, in this case, is how many rules are falling on top of each other in a kind of pile-up landscape. And the examples that take several hours to compute, here's one for 50, these are for 50,000 random rules, they create this kind of landscape. And we can simply probe different points on this landscape after the sample is sorted in various ways to see what the rules are and the dynamics of those rules. Now, the rules up in this mountain are chaotic, so they're not that interesting. That's why one can do a search in this whole area, but don't worry about the chaotic rules. These are very promising around here because they're kind of ordered, and we find the not only gliders but also stable or localized configurations like eters, reflectors, oscillators, and so on, which can interact with gliders to form the logical gates. So, looking at a review of the glider guns, the rules that have glider guns, or have constructed glider guns, or emergent glider guns, so far. The game of life, various other rules, Emmanuel Sapin's rule, rules that I've found with my colleague Jose Manuel Gomez Soto in Zacatecas, Mexico, and a rule with quite a long time ago found by myself and Andrew Adamatsky. And also, this is going back a long way, the beehive rule, which is a B3K6 rule, has a glider gun, but no stable configurations to collide with the gliders. Because strangely, the beehive rule also works in 3D, and so does the spiral rule. Now, I'm going on to a quick Didi Lab demo. And that's the website of Didi Lab. And here goes. Here's the Didi Lab window. And I'm going to quickly set up the game of life, for instance. which has 9 neighbors, is 2D. I'll give it the lattice of size. Life, we can define survival birth in any way we like, but actually the game of life is the default. And this is the full lookup table of the game of life. We're now going to transform it to its ISO rule, which is that, which is a string of zeros and ones. There's the string unfolded. And we can also examine the prototype, the ISO groups, the groups that make up the ISO rule. So the first one is all ones. There's only one of them, so it's a group of one. But if we look at all the groups, then there they are. Some are this members of the group, some more or less. And then we can look at all the if I go back, this is the entire list of all the prototypes, from all ones to all zeros. Now, we need an initial state. So I'm going to load the game of life glider gun. There it is. And this glider gun is credited to Gosper, who constructed it by some kind of magic, having seen the gliders in other structures in Conway's Game of Life before it had a glider gun. So we're going to run this and show the histogram based on ISO rules. There's the histogram, and I'm going to simply convert this into log, so we can see all the bars. And I'm going to give I know this is going too fast. There's lightning speed here, but on the video it's probably very slow. So I'm going to give the gliders a little trail. So anything that's been moving for a while gets a green trail. Now, if I'm randomized the initial state, then maybe gliders will emerge, maybe they won't. Usually you do find them in the game of life from a random state. Let's do a central random state. And they don't always emerge. But I'll go back to the glider gun. Now, let's see the glider gun colored according to the histogram colors. And now if we filter, the black dots appear down here, but because they seek the most active bars, and then we can gradually filter everything out. But then we can override that to see the pattern anyway, although it's filtered. And now we can start to mutate. And then there'll be red bars. Now, if the mutation hits a inactive bar, I don't know what happened there. I think the glider gun is still working. Okay. Contract. Now, let's look at the... I think something strange has happened because I've mutated. So if I unmutate in reverse order and get the glider gun back, I'm going to look at the scatter plot that we talked about. Okay, here's our scatter plot. If we click on it, we'll get the rules that reside there. So if I click on K on this area here, I'll get many, many rules. So I have to sort of keep pressing return for more. Or I can simply define a patch and see the rules within the patch. But let's look at all these rules out here, which have a very high min-max entropy, very high variability of the entropy. And let's also see the landscape of this scatter plot. There it is. But that's just for an impression, which is very useful. But this is the graph where you can probe it and see the dynamics. So I'm going to now look at those very variable. Let's do this in color. Okay, so we're looking at high entropy variability. And we do see gliders straight away. We may not see very many. Let's speed this up. Another initial state, and we can filter that. So a few more. There's really no time to look seriously at no one has really examined this, the landscape of the scatter plot. But there's a lot of good stuff there. And the other thing I should say is that the parameters, when you set up the scatter plot, can be biased, and I think they have been biased in this case, to favor finding interesting rules. So the density of different colors and the density of the outputs in the ISO rule plays a part. So I'm going to go back now, and I think there's still a tiny bit of time, and show multi-value version. So we'll have, in this case, we'll have three colors and seven neighbors in 2D and make it, say, 88 by 88. load. Spiral rule, and that's its full lookup table, and we convert it to an ISO rule, and then we load the spiral rule glider gun. Now it's got the glider gun, we've got a few more bits in there. So I'll run that. And I'm going to show the histogram. The histogram has more than one row to fit in log form, and show it in color. Well, first of all, I'll show it with a green trail. Now, if I put in a random initial state, it's very likely this glider gun will just appear without prompting. It's an emergent glider gun. You don't need to construct it, you just find it. So let's see, yeah, there's one up here. There's a glider gun. It's interacting very nicely with these stable structures where it can actually leave and remove a cell from its periphery. This is the same thing in color. Sorry, I forgot to slow it down. No, that should be slow enough for people to see. And we'll go back to do another random initial state. See if we get another glider gun. So some glider guns, here's one. Now they're actually two types in the spiral rule, with different frequency of shooting gliders, different spacing of gliders. On the right of the screen, these are all the on-the-fly options that can be done without pausing. So I can continue looking. So that can be removed or brought back. Now, this is a hexagonal grid, and one can show, for instance, the divisions of the grid, like this. And the different colors, like that. But I'll get rid of that. Now, let's look very quickly at the scatter plot for this type of rule. Okay, so very similar, and we can click anywhere, get the rules, run them, examine them, and having loaded the scatterplot of 50,000 rules, I can look at the ones right out here on this outer extreme edge. So I'm going to do that. So there's the most outlying one, and then we come in. And while we're doing this, we can, of course, filter and unfilter. look at another one. So, you know, one can lose oneself in staring at the screen. I think it's a bit dangerous. Or maybe some people may find it like a calming Zen-like effect. So let's filter this one. Okay, unfilter. Okay, I'm going to abandon that. And the very last thing I'll show you is 3D. So this will be the same rule, actually, the spiral that I showed you before, which was a collaboration with Andy Adamatsky. 7 neighbors, 3D. Now, I'm going to make this 3D a kind of box, a shallow box, 40 by 10 by 40. And I'm going to load the spiral rule. Convert it to an ISO rule. And then look at the prototype templates. So there's the first one, which is index 170. So there are 170 groups. I'm going to show all the groups. So sometimes you get a lot of members of the group. And here is the prototype groups, which define the prototype groups. They hadn't started at the top. So if I put in here 170, which is the top one, then I can show, but they don't all fit. So what I can do is contract the scale, and maybe they'll fit now. Yeah, so they fit now. So all twos, all zeros, and now we're going to run this. And we're going to load a glider gun. Okay, here's our glider gun. Now, when I run this, because the boundary conditions are periodic, it'll kind of destroy itself. But what I'll do is allow the gliders to just fall off the edges. And then we'll be able to see them continuing. So. There we are. So now I'm going to change the boundary conditions. And then there we go. And I'll slow it down. We've just put a kind of grid in here to help visualize it. This is, again, the input frequency histogram. And the entropy There it is. It's not changing very much because a glider gun is actually stable. But I can change the, I can change the analysis size to 1, and then it'll become more jagged. Now, if I put in a random initial state like that, we may not see this glider gun emerging. But I found it by just looking at this kind of thing and isolating the pattern that became the glider gun. Now let me slow this down. So speed up, slow down a bit. There's the glider gun again in color. And with that, I'm going to conclude. Thank you very, very much for listening. This is Didi Lab. It has a website. There's also a book called Exploring Discrete Dynamics, the second edition, but this is kept up to date online. So I revised it online. And that's the website, and very soon I'll be announcing this update for ISO rules. At the moment, it's listing something else. So on that note, I will stop recording if I can find the button. How can I stop recording? No idea. Stop share. Maybe stop share and end. Thank you very much.